Thank you. The next item of business is a member's business debate on motion 2911 in the name of Ruth Maguire on online pimping. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put, and I would ask those members who wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons now. And I call on Ruth Maguire to open the debate. 7 minutes, please, Ms Maguire.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Today I'm calling for three things: that the Scottish Government urgently outlaw online pimping, that traffickers and exploiters are held to account with the full force of our criminal justice system, and that comprehensive support and exiting services for women advertised and exploited via pimping websites is provided. I'd like to begin by thanking colleagues from Labour, the Conservatives and the SNP for supporting my motion and enabling this debate to go ahead, and thank everyone who's contributing today. I'm grateful to UK Feminista, who supported and facilitated the inquiry, and to all those who took part. I also wish to thank those who've provided briefing materials and feedback for today, but particularly A Model for Scotland. I'll declare an interest as a member of the steering group. However, it's the members of the group, the women who generously and openly share their lived experience and expertise, those who've exited prostitution, the frontline organisations who work with women, and the grassroots campaigners who do the real work. I'm grateful to know them and feel very privileged to work with them. Their courage and tenacity is awe-inspiring. In 2021, the Scottish Parliament's cross-party group on commercial sexual exploitation, which I co-convene with Rhoda Grant, conducted an inquiry into pimping websites. I think that most people in Scotland would be surprised that our country at the moment is a place where our current laws mean that criminal gangs profiting from the sexual exploitation of women can hide in plain sight using so-called adult services websites. A quick glance at one of those sites today would show you that in this city, right now, there are women who have been trafficked here both from out with and within our borders, who are being subjected to abuse, violence and humiliation to satisfy the demand of a minority of men. And this is not just happening in Edinburgh, but right across the country. Scotland's laws on prostitution have not kept pace with technological change. As a result, commercial pimping websites, which advertise individuals for prostitution across Scotland, currently operate openly and freely. So the problem we face, Presiding Officer, is online pimping is legal and fuels sex trafficking in Scotland. Detective Superintendent Filippo Capaldi, forgive me, head of Police Scotland's National Human Trafficking Unit, told our inquiry, "Adult services websites are one of the main facilitators of trafficking for the purposes of sexual exploitation in Scotland and the rest of the UK, and we come across them quite commonly when we're dealing with trafficking inquiries, particularly involving foreign nationals." Pimping websites enable and incentivise sex trafficking and sexual exploitation. These websites, which host adverts for prostitution, expand the scale of sexual exploitation, enabling anyone on the internet to anonymously access women being advertised for prostitution. Websites are routinely used by sex traffickers, and there's no realistic way that the website operators can prevent this. Most prostitution advertising now takes place online, rather than on the street or in local newspapers. A small number of websites dominate this online advertising marketplace. These market-leading websites centralise and concentrate demand from sex buyers across Scotland. By placing an advert on one of these sites, trafficking gangs can quickly and easily advertise their victims to sex buyers across the country, as well as move their victims between different locations by simply altering the location information on their advert. Frankly put, these websites make the brutal business of sex trafficking easier and quicker for criminals. They do not deliver protection or security to the women being advertised on them. On the contrary, they typically openly display the phone numbers of the women being advertised, allowing anyone with access to the internet to immediately and anonymously access these women. There is also no way that website operators can identify if a woman is being advertised on their site, if she's being exploited by a third party, such as a trafficker or pimp. As Megan King, a survivor of prostitution, told our inquiry, "When I was handed over to my first client, at which point I had no idea I was being sold into the sex trade, that client took intimate photos of me, some in my underwear and others more intimate and degrading. The underwear shots were then used as a profile picture on my adult work profile that my pimp created, without my knowledge or consent. There's no real way the website can verify that woman is the same woman that's then sold to a punter. In my situation, I believe that the pimp's wife took passport photographs under which all of the girls were then advertised. An inquiry by the UK Parliament's All Parliamentary Group on Prostitution and the Global Sex Trade concluded that pimping websites are now core to the typical business model of sex trafficking. These websites have turbocharged the sex trafficking trade. The websites incentivise sexual exploitation by making it quick and easy for pimps and traffickers to advertise their victims to men who pay for sex. This online pimping is taking place on an industrial scale in Scotland, yet their operations fall through the cracks of our outdated prostitution laws, and website owners profit from this exploitation with impunity. The Scottish Government must, with urgency, get on with adopting laws against sexual exploitation that are fit for the 21st century. That requires making it a criminal offence to enable or profit from the prostitution of another person. Tackling men's demand by criminalising paying for sex and decriminalising and supporting victims of sexual exploitation. Presiding Officer, it's time to get serious about men's violence against women and girls in all its forms. It's time to put pimps and traffickers out of business. Thank you.
Thank you. And I now call on Eleanor Whittam to be followed by Russell Finlay. Up to 4 minutes, please, Ms. Whittam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Firstly, let me express my gratitude to my colleague Ruth Maguire for securing this important debate and to my colleagues in the Cross-Party Group on Ending Commercial Sex Exploitation for their determined and focused work to highlight the brutal business that is the world of online pimping. In Scotland, we have a government that rightly recognises prostitution as a form of violence against women, and our equally safe strategy underlines this. We need to implement a challenge and demand approach whereby it is the sex buyer who is recognised as the driver for this violence, and in turn, the pimps, whether on the streets, in brothels or operating online, are understood to be the traffickers and suppliers of prostituted women. It beggars belief that men in Scotland are able to simply turn on their smartphones and open up the likes of Viva Street platform and order themselves access to a woman's body as easily as they may order a pizza. What does that say about the position of women in our society? Commodities to be bought and sold, trafficked and abused from coast to coast. There's very little empowerment for women in a system that allows online platform companies and pimps to get rich at the bodily expense of women. I recently watched the Panorama documentary Online Pimps Exposed, which saw investigative journalist Brona Munro take a forensic look at the Viva Street platform, where you can buy a second-hand car as easily as you can find a woman in your own vicinity to exploit. Now, whilst the company maintained that they do all they can to prevent pimps from operating on the site, this is not believable when the programme uncovered evidence that hundreds of ads included the same mobile phone number and the same language, including all of the same grammatical errors, but advertised multiple women. Clear warning signs that Viva Street should have picked up on as indicators of sexual exploitation. A known Northern Irish trafficker was followed as he picked up women at airports who were then quickly added to the platform and access to their bodies for sale within hours. This clearly indicates sexual exploitation for financial gain. The news documentary also featured interviews with Detective Sergeant Stuart Pell, who runs the exploitation team at Lancashire Police, and he told Panorama, and I quote, "Every single job is Viva Street. They advertise over Viva Street. It is very common knowledge that if you need sexual services, Viva Street is the place that you'll find it. You can arrange what you want the girl to look like. It's like a takeaway menu. There isn't one single job I have done that's not Viva Street." This is echoed by Detective Superintendent Filippo Capaldi, head of Scotland's Police National Human Trafficking Unit, who said, "Adult services websites are one of the main facilitators of trafficking for the purposes of sexual exploitation in Scotland and the rest of the UK, and we come across them quite commonly when we're dealing with trafficking inquiries, particularly involving foreign nationals." There have been numerous prosecutions of pimping and sex trafficking involving people who have used Viva Street to advertise the women they are exploiting. In one case in the northwest of England, a man spent £25,000 on adverts in Viva Street in 2017. They actually gave him his own personal account manager. What does that say? A Model for Scotland briefing for today's debate further outlines that a small number of highly lucrative pimping sites, websites continue to dominate the online marketing place for the advertising of prostitution. They are the go-to websites for sex buyers looking to find a woman to pay for sex. As a result, pimping websites centralise and concentrate demand from sex buyers online. Finally, Presiding Officer, women are being murdered and assaulted in appalling numbers. We cannot disengage this reality from the exploitation of women involved in prostitution and pornography. Violence against women must be seen in all of its forms and in all of the places it exists. Reducing women to commodities harms all of us, and our laws must reflect this. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call on Russell Finlay to be followed by Colette Stevenson. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr. Finlay.
Thank you. I congratulate Ruth Maguire on bringing forward this important debate, and I'm very glad for the opportunity to speak in it. As MSPs, we get bombarded with a vast amount of information from political parties, public and professional bodies, members of the public, pressure groups, charities, along with many others, and I don't think any of us can really say we claim to read it all. However, I would urge all members to take the time to read the report on online pimping, which has been produced by the cross-party group on commercial sexual exploitation. This is a thorough and well-researched piece of work which lays bare the extent of the online sex industry and the hugely complex issues around how best to deal with it. The report identifies four main websites operating in the UK. Today, one of those websites contains 905 adverts for prostitution, often euphemistically misnamed as escorting. Of those adverts, 358 are in Glasgow, with 176 in Edinburgh. But it's not just our big cities, with women for sale today in all but two of our 32 local authority areas. Some of the content is deeply disturbing. A cursory look yields an advert containing the word schoolgirl. There are women from many countries, including those such as Romania, which have associations with the trafficking of people. Now, these CD websites are a window into a deeply disturbing and dangerous world. Services and prices are displayed alongside photos of these women, who we are expected to believe have made the choice to do what they are doing. The report makes clear that many of these women are treated as no more than commodities, enslaved by cross-border criminal gangs. One of the most shocking findings of the CPG report is that the median time a sex trafficking victim is held captive is 274 days, or approximately 9 months. In that time, they will be raped 795 times. I note with interest the competing views about how law enforcement deals with these websites and the sex trade more generally. It seems the police have sought to engage with these sites in order to try and identify and catch criminal gangs and offer some form of protection to the victims. The police approach seems to be based on pragmatism and an acceptance that the trade in sex will always be with us. However, the CPG report suggests a much more robust approach is necessary, citing France as an example. One concern is that this may drive the trade further underground, potentially making it even harder for the police and increasing the danger to women. While I can appreciate both perspectives, I'm sure this will be the subject of continued debate. Now, I've only got 4 minutes, so I'd like to conclude by categorically agreeing with others that men are the catalyst for this online trade in women. Just as men have controlled sex for sale throughout the ages, long before the internet, it is men who use violence and threats to control their female victims, and it is men who maintain the trade by paying for sex with absolutely no regard for the subjugation and misery they are fuelling. This trade is part of a broader societal issues affecting women and girls, from the sexualisation of children, the abundance of pornography, female exploitation, everyday sexism and discrimination, right through to a criminal justice system in which women continue to be failed, as was acknowledged in here this week by the Cabinet Secretary for Justice. Last year, it was reported that an English university was offering sessions to support students involved in sex work, and I agree with the UK Higher Education Minister, Michelle Donnellan, who said this was legitimising a dangerous industry. Finally, I would like to conclude by stating that it is incumbent on all men to stand up and be counted, to be part of the solution and not part of the problem.
Thank you. Thank you. I now call on Colette Stevenson to be followed by Rosa Grant. Up to 4 minutes, please, Ms Stevenson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I thank Ruth Maguire for bringing forward this debate and also for her work on the cross-party group on commercial sexual exploitation. The group's report on online pimping was a detailed but harrowing piece of work that covers so many bases. In many cases, girls and women are trafficked and then bought, sold or hired by men for the purpose of sexual violence and exploitation. Unfortunately, that's not new, but the rise of the internet has changed the landscape and, as the CPG report notes, fuelled a demand and grew the market in recent years. In the past, men who paid for sex were at risk of being caught by frequenting red light districts. Nowadays, men can access websites to buy women by the hour just as easily as they can do online grocery shopping. Rightly, the Scottish Government recognises prostitution as an example of gender-based violence. Equally safe, as we've heard, is the national strategy to prevent and eradicate all forms of violence against women and girls. It has also been adapted for schools to embed gender equality into our education system and prevent gender-based violence. This is important for so many reasons, including in relation to men's demand for prostitution. Research from the Sandiford Clinic in Glasgow found that men who had not purchased sex by the age of 25 are less likely to ever do so. By educating boys and young men and highlighting that prostitution is sexual exploitation, we can hopefully curb some of that demand. We also need reforms to the law in terms of those who pay for sex, and the need to end commercial sexual exploitation is clear. I know the Scottish Government has been considering international best practice in terms of tackling the harms associated with prostitution, and I welcome the commitment to develop a model which will reduce the harms of prostitution and challenge men's demands, but will also support women to exit prostitution. Right now, as Ruth Maguire points out, online pimping is legal, but those women who may well have been trafficked are criminally liable. Equally Safe emphasises the importance of exit services to support women to leave prostitution and move on with their lives. Importantly, these women deserve to be treated. Without fear of judgment and discrimination. Women who have been involved in prostitution experience huge stigma, but the outrage should be directed towards those men who buy sex. It's crucial that the model for Scotland tackles the stigma experienced by women, encourages them to come forward and get the help and support they are entitled to, and not make the victims of sexual exploitation the people who face criminalisation. Presiding Officer, I commend the cross-party group on its inquiry. I want to thank everyone involved for their work, and especially to those women, those survivors of sexual exploitation who are trying to affect change. The Scottish Government's approach to date has been good, but we need legislative changes. It's time to outlaw online pimping, and I look forward to hearing an update from the Minister on the planned reforms.
Thank you. I now call Rhoda Grant to be followed by Maggie Chapman. Up to 4 minutes, please, Ms Grant.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I too would like to congratulate Ruth Maguire on securing this debate and also say it's really good to see her back in the chamber. We all know and recognise that prostitution is violence against women. In a country that values equality, men should not be able to buy access to other people's bodies. This is male violence, and it is the abuse of power, and it has no place in Scotland. Yet today there are 1,595 women in sale in Scotland on Viva Street in Adult Works. And this is because there is a sizeable minority of men in Scotland who are abusive, and they lead to the creation of a lucrative industry. The pimps, traffickers and brothel keepers exploit that market, but to do so, they need to be able to advertise their victims to sex buyers.
These pimps are the same whether they advertise on the street, own a brothel or operate a website. They facilitate and profit from the prostitution of others. Viva Street, Adult Works and the rest of them are simply that. They are pimps. Making money through promoting violence against women and exploiting people to feed this appalling trade. The truth is that prostitution is very lucrative to those who manage it. These websites say they have measures in place to stop victims of trafficking being advertised on their sites. But as we heard from Ruth Maguire, our witnesses in the report tell us very different, and Megan King's evidence was alarming. Elaine Witham cited last year's BBC Panorama broadcast, an investigation into Viva Street, that exposed how pimps and their traffickers used the site to advertise their victims. The journalist who led the investigation, Brona Munro, said, "I was able to identify a pattern surrounding phone numbers, surrounding the names of the women that were being advertised, the names of women that were passing through multiple postcodes. There were hundreds of numbers connected to multiple ads. Of the 12,000 ads I looked at, they were littered with adverts that I would say were concerning. Surely if she can see that, surely then so should the police." Elena also quoted the case that shows how seriously Viva Street takes the issue of sex trafficking. The single trafficker who spent £25,000. Prior to their arrest, Viva Street did not respond to the man's high rate of spending on prostitution adverts by calling the police, but they allocated him an account manager. Pimping websites have a major vested interest in prostitution and will oppose any attempts to combat that exploitation. National Ugly Mugs, a charity which is launching Numbrella Lane, a service in Scotland for people involved in the sex trade. They have the Viva Street logo on their homepage of their website, listed as one of their funders. Their website states, "We have a long-standing relationship with Viva Street that began in 2015. Last year, National Ugly Mugs lobbied the Scottish Government through the Equally Safe consultation to fully decriminalise the sex trade, including third parties. The relationship between exploiters and organisations promoting decriminalisations of pimps is close, making money out of misery and using it to further the cause of misery. They must be stopped."
Thank you. I now call on Maggie Chapman to be followed by Bill Kidd. Up to 4 minutes, please, Ms Chapman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I thank Ruth Maguire for bringing this debate to the Chamber today because it allows me to give voice to those not represented by the Sexual Exploitation Inquiry Report, sex workers. As we seek to tackle violence against women and girls, including sex trafficking, we should follow the evidence to ensure we support sex workers, keep them safe, and tackle the causes and structures that enable both sex trafficking and violence against women and girls.
Ruth Maguire.
Maggie Chapman giving way. I just wonder if she'd acknowledge, we may call them different names, but those prostitutes, people who'd been involved in prostitution were very much represented in our inquiry. We spoke with those who were involved in what might be deemed high class prostitution and people who'd been victimised in the street. Current sex workers were also invited to take part. They declined.
Maggie Chapman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As I'll come to, I will talk about the responses that Scott Pepp, who represents sex workers, how their evidence was not included in that report. I do not agree that outlawing adult services websites will stop sex trafficking and deliver the kinds of changes that the motion outlines. Sex workers and groups that support and represent them do not want online platforms to be banned, and they highlight three key reasons for this. First, sex workers use online platforms to screen clients to improve safety. They also use them to connect with each other, reducing isolation and keeping each other up to date with risk alerts. I'm going to make some progress if I may, thank you. Second, if online platforms were banned, it would force sex workers into on-street and other informal ways of working. This could disrupt their income streams, causing economic hardship, I'm going to make progress, if I may, and would lead to survival sex work, which is more unsafe. There is clear evidence from the US where, following the Allow States and Victims to Fight Online Sex Trafficking Act and Stop Enabling Sex Traffickers Act of 2018, violence experienced by sex workers increased, as did their vulnerability to pimps. It also, perhaps unexpectedly, negatively affected their ability to find other forms of work. They were less able to deal with mental and physical health issues and therefore less able to secure alternative employment. And third, banning online platforms risks displacing activities to the dark web and other unregulatable spaces where there is far more risk of harm and less scope for outreach, safety, and support services. The dark web is already used by traffickers. Banning online sites now will not stop that. Beyond the Gaze, a research project funded by the Economic and Social Research Council found that sex workers overwhelmingly agreed that the internet had enabled them to work independently of pimps and managers, screen clients effectively, find out about their rights as workers and people, access networks and support, and improve the quality of their working lives. Rather than criminalising and endangering sex workers, I urge the Scottish Government and those speaking in this debate today to engage with sex workers themselves, speak to them, to explore how we can regulate adult services sites, improve safety, secure rights and options for earning the money needed to live, whilst also addressing poverty, economic insecurity and structural inequality. I would also encourage you all to read Scott Pepp's response to the CPG Sexual Exploitation Inquiry. Their evidence wasn't included in that report. I will close with the words of a young sex worker in Edinburgh. Jay says, "I know firsthand the impact removing online advertising spaces causes, as my colleagues in the United States were being contacted by pimps, being told that it is different now and claiming that we need them. I don't want to see sex workers in Scotland pushed back into the hands of managers. When I started sex working at 21, I worked in a brothel where a manager took 60% of my earnings and I kept 40%. Being able to work alone has helped me keep my earnings, helped me to achieve stable housing, and allowed me to claw my way out of poverty. We must abolish poverty, not force women working in sex work into worse and more dangerous conditions in the name of saving them." Thank you.
Thank you. I now call on Bill Kidd to be followed by Mercedes Villalba. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr. Kidd.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and thank you also to our colleague Ruth Maguire for lodging this motion for debate. I want to begin by stating my support for the A Model for Scotland campaign and to urge my fellow MSPs to publicly support the campaign as well. I agree that legislation is required to account for technological change, which has significantly increased the levels of sex trafficking and exploitation taking place in Scotland. As members will be aware, Rhoda Grant MSP was kind enough to arrange a briefing on the A Model for Scotland campaign last December, and this is still available online. During this, Valiant Ritchie, the coordinator for tackling human trafficking in Europe for the OSCE, that's the Organisation for Security and Cooperation in Europe, spoke about the scale of the issue at hand. He highlighted that 10 years ago, a study concluded that technology is the single greatest facilitator of the commercial sex industry, and he went on to say that over the course of the past decade, the only thing that has changed that conclusion is that the situation has grown much worse. This is confirmed by police leading convictions against traffickers in the UK, noticeably from Sergeant Peel, that the scale of sex trafficking cannot be met by current police resources, and these websites incentivise trafficking by increasing profitability. This brings us to our debate today, where we as legislators have the power and ability to begin the process of closing the legislative gap and look to stop online pimping websites from facilitating mass exploitation in Scotland whilst evading the law. Detective Chief Superintendent McCluskey, Head of Police Protection for Scotland, recently awarded the Queen's Police Medal, described online pimping websites as the most significant enablers of sexual exploitation in Scotland. Should this Parliament move forward and legislate on this matter, I would urge fellow parliamentarians to remain informed and grounded about the horrific reality of the abuse and misery of sexual exploitation and trafficking, and this includes against children. I would underline that there is no such thing as a good or safe buyer of prostitution. In fact, I think that's farcical. Our laws already recognise the abhorrent nature of sex trafficking and prostitution. I urge MSPs to anticipate that there will be false dichotomies and false narratives put forward by lobby groups that are paid for by those profiting from the illegal industry, including by people convicted of human trafficking offences. This can also come from people who have heard these narratives and whose information on the issue may vary. Going back to the OSCE coordinator for tackling trafficking in 57 countries from Europe, Central Asia and North America, Mr. Ritchie explained that the advertising of women for sale on these websites opens a gateway to harm. These websites allow, on a great scale, the intersection of somebody paying for sex with someone who did not come to that transaction willingly. Rather, whether a woman or a child, that person finds themselves trapped as a result of coercion, abuse, or preying on vulnerability. The whole transaction is rendered as non-sexual sex. These websites facilitate mass rape and, in the UK, have been linked to many cases of further violence and indeed homicides. They should not be legal under any circumstances. These websites are against human rights. Mass rape is not a human flourishing. Rather, it is the worst possible kind of degradation against people who are the most vulnerable in our society. Examples from the US and Israel show how successful legislation can be in shutting down the operation of these websites. For example, after FOSTA SESTA was passed, the online marketplace of these websites in the US dropped 80% in 72 hours. It's our responsibility as MSPs to act to the limits of our abilities and to take this issue and the protection of the victims of exploitation and trafficking seriously. Thank you very much, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. I now call on Mercedes Villalba to be followed by Paul McLennan, who will be the last speaker in the open debate. Up to 4 minutes, please, Ms. Villalba.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I won't be taking interventions, as the dominant view has already been very well represented in today's debate. I would like to thank Ruth Maguire for bringing forward this motion for debate today. I believe her concerns are genuine, but I'm concerned that moves to criminalise online platforms used by sex workers will actually increase the risk to their safety. Sex workers themselves have said that they use online platforms to screen clients, to improve safety, and to connect with each other for support. These platforms are also providing greater opportunities for sex workers to access outreach, safety and support services, and this is more likely than would be the case in unregulated online spaces like the dark web. So that's why I believe it's important that any decisions which could affect the safety and livelihoods of sex workers be taken after meaningful consultation with those in work and be based on evidence. And the evidence from studies so far shows that the vast majority of sex workers believe that there are benefits to their use of online platforms. The Beyond the Gaze project surveyed sex workers who agreed that online platforms had improved their safety and their ability to access support. These workers also noted that online platforms enabled them to screen clients, engage with sex worker networks, and access support services. And crucially, the vast majority of them believed that both advertising sexual services online and purchasing these services should be legal. So what happens when a criminalisation approach is pursued? In the USA, they've opted for criminalisation of online platforms through the FOSTA SESTA law and the End Banking for Human Traffickers Act. Research published in the Anti-Trafficking Review found that these laws had increased the financial insecurity of sex workers, with some forced to move offline to work on the streets or through an exploitative third party. The laws have also undermined sex workers' safety with the loss of web-based harm reduction tools, which helped to identify clients with a history of violence. So the result of these laws has been to push these workers into more dangerous ways of working, into greater financial insecurity, and away from support networks. and they were passed in the face of opposition from workers, from anti-trafficking organisations, from criminal defence lawyers and from LGBT health and social justice organisations. The approach taken by the US is the clearest example of policy being made in spite of evidence and without meaningful consultation with those affected. As I've said before, if we're serious about supporting people to exit sex work, we have to tackle the underlying material issues which often drive people into sex work in the first place. Some of these issues are long-standing, like a lack of employment or education opportunities and inadequate social security provision. Others are being worsened by the current cost of living crisis, like rent, food prices, and heating. So given these underlying material issues, the criminalisation of online platforms will not help individuals to leave sex work. Instead, it will leave sex workers facing greater risks to their safety, it will drive them into financial insecurity, and it will deny them access to support networks and services. The proposal to criminalise online platforms is neither based on the evidence nor the views of sex workers. We need a new approach. That's why I continue to believe that we should pursue decriminalisation of sex work, offline and online. I'd like to conclude with a comment from a sex worker reflecting on the Foster-Sesta law. It was written to remind us that our lives are dispensable. We are not protected. Our work is unseen and irrelevant. It was written to destabilise our ability to live with any degree of agency.
Thank you. I now call on Paul McLennan, who will be the last speaker in the open debate, as I said. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr McLennan.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I also thank Ruth Maguire for bringing forward this debate today, and can I thank CARE and Model for Scotland for the briefings for the debates today. Prostitution remains an inherently exploitative form, and let's call it what it is, it's gender-based violence, no more, no less. The law as it stands presently means that this form of violence against women is wholly within the law, which is unthinkable in any other context. We've heard about the government deserves credit for its equally safe strategy, and I agree with that, and its recognition of prostitution as a form of violence against women, and its stated commitment to develop a tailored Scottish model to tackle prostitution. In the briefing, a model for Scotland stated, online pimping is currently legal in Scotland. As a result, highly lucrative pimping websites operate without impunity. Many people in Scotland don't see this, and they're unaware of the issues this has caused in Scotland. Every day, we heard Rhoda Grant saying there's around about 1,500 to 2,000 women for sale now, today, which is incredible. Pimping websites play a key role in enabling and incentivising sex trafficking and sexual exploitation in Scotland. As a result, the websites make it quick and easy for traffickers and pimps to advertise their victims to sex buyers across the country. We heard Elena Whittam talk about it's as easy as going shopping. You just go online, 2 minutes later, that's it. You buy a woman. You buy a woman. The Scottish Government is committed to challenge men's demand for prostitution and support women to exit sexual exploitation. To achieve that goal, Model for Scotland asked for the Scottish Government to outlaw online pimping, hold exploiters to account and deliver comprehensive support and existing services for individuals advertised and exploited through the pimping websites. We've heard obviously about the cross-party group and what they found. And the three main issues, obviously, one was the pimping websites not only facilitate and profit from the prostitution of others, that commercial pimping websites are designed to facilitate and profit from this form of violence against women. And they also incentivise and enable sex trafficking by centralising and concentrating demand online. We've heard already before that a small number of highly lucrative websites dominate the marketplace in Scotland. And one of the other key things as well is that they're a market expanding force. These sites can be set up pretty quickly. It's no legal expertise. They can open it up pretty quickly. It's on an industrial scale, obviously, in which exploitation already takes place. The size and the scale of prostitution trade is not constant. It's a context dependent. Now, I want to touch on this as an important part about the evidence base to support the recommendations. We've heard it being used in a couple of ways around about online pimping. In the States, we've obviously heard about the Stop Enabling Sex Traffickers Act in 2017. There was a website then called Backpage, which was previously a major pimping website at that time, which has seen its demand significantly disrupted and seen a real reduction in demand in websites in that regard. Online pimping in France is illegal. Legislation makes illegal assisting or profiting from another person's prostitution. It's punishable by 7 years' imprisonment and a fine of €150,000. The sentence can also increase to 20 years' imprisonment and a £3 million fine if the offence is committed by an organised group. Presiding Officer, in conclusion, and this is a key part of evidence for myself, Valerie Enrichie from the OSCE, who is a coordinator for combating trafficking human beings, said government should really be considering policy options to shut down these sites as quickly as possible. It is made much easier for traffickers to advertise people and much easier for buyers to find them. At any time you can reduce that threshold, these barriers to access in the market, you are going to see more engagement, and that has been the major problem. It also reduces the risk for traffickers, so it makes it much more attractive. Online pimping is wrong. It is symptomatic of gender-based violence against women and has no place in Scotland in 2022. Thank you.
Thank you. And I now call on... Point of order, Rosie Grant.
Presiding Officer, I think Maggie Chapman may have inadvertently misled the Chamber. On the 12th of October 2020, Ruth Maguire contacted ScotPEB, inviting them to give oral evidence to the cross-party group inquiry. On the 10th of November that year, I wrote to them again extending the invitation to give oral evidence, but also suggesting they might wish to give written evidence again if that wasn't possible. On the 12th of November, again, I wrote to ScotPEB asking them to give evidence to the inquiry, either oral or written. We had no response to that.
I thank the member for her contribution. I would suggest that's not a point of order on the basis that it is not a matter for the chair as to the content of statements and contributions from members. However, the member has made her point, which will be in the official report. I call on the Minister, Ash Regan, to respond to the debate. Around 7 minutes, please, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I'd like to start by thanking Ruth Maguire for raising this motion and commend the cross-party group on commercial sexual exploitation for their report. It highlights the cross-cutting issues related to online pimping, such as its role in facilitating human trafficking, and the underlying issues of how women are viewed in society, which is timely to mention with the Independent Working Group on Misogyny, which is due to publish its report later this month. So I thought Ms Maguire's speech today was an unflinching portrait of this grim issue. There were many excellent speeches across the chamber today, and I never thought I would get to this point, but I do, or I am quite in agreement with Russell Finlay on many of the points that he raised in his speech. However, I cannot agree with either Maggie Chapman or Mercedes Villalba on both their assessment of the issue or the approach that we should take to it. One of the things that was mentioned was, of course, listening to prostituted women, and I agree that is very important. And Rhoda Grant's point of order that she just made there did show that, of course, that is an important part of it. We want to listen. And for the members' information, Scott Pepper also on the government's reference group. So we are, of course, listening very carefully to what they have to say. I would agree that it is really important. And I think as well that I have spoken to a number of women who've been involved in prostitution. So I just wanted to assure members that that is something that I do take very, very seriously. But I would urge the members to really look at the reality of prostitution in countries that have pursued a decriminalisation model and the high level of trafficking that's involved and the conditions that are involved and ones which, I'm sorry to say, are very far from safe for the women that are involved there. And also the levels of commoditisation, which was a theme I think that came up quite a lot during the debate this afternoon. And I would reflect that this type of inhumane commoditisation, it harms the women that are involved in this, but it also harms, I think, and impacts on society's view of all women. So my question to both would be, is this appropriate and is this desirable? Is this what we want to see in Scotland? And I would say that it is not. So the Scottish Government is very clear that misogyny fuels violence against women and girls. It erodes our efforts to make progress and to address gender equality. And women's bodies being commodified in this way and purchased by men is, of course, a deeply misogynistic behaviour. And let me be clear that an exchange for sex or sexual service is not about sex. It's about power, it's about control, and the persistence of structures which normalise these harmful behaviours within our society. An equally safe definition includes the full spectrum of violence against women, and it doesn't prioritise tackling one behaviour over another, and I think that was something that was mentioned by Elena Whittam in her contribution, in order to achieve equality, and recognises that that forms of gender violence frequently overlap. A recent Encompass snapshot survey demonstrated this. So the survey showed that 36% of the women disclosed experiences of childhood sexual abuse, 83% of the women disclosed experiences of domestic abuse, and 20% of women disclosed that they were under 18 when they were first involved in selling sex or sexual images. And our commitment to tackling prostitution is in line with our intention to incorporate the UN Convention on the Elimination of All Forms of Discrimination Against Women into Scots law. And Article 6 in particular compels Scotland to take all appropriate measures, including legislation, to suppress all forms of trafficking and exploitation of women through prostitution. And this is a global call to action and one that we must respond to. And this year's programme for government commits to this. It commits the government to develop a model for Scotland to challenge men's demand for prostitution. And in doing so, it adds to a series of policy actions being taken forward to root out misogynistic behaviours in society. And the cross-party working group report has called for a number of legislative solutions to address certain activities associated with prostitution and to restrict pimps and traffickers' room to operate and exploit. And there are a number of laws in Scotland which make certain activities associated with prostitution illegal. So these are running a brothel, public solicitation to sell or purchase sex, loitering to sell or purchase, or procuring someone into becoming a prostitute and trafficking for the purposes of sexual exploitation. Now, I fully recognise that these laws are piecemeal and they were not consistently developed against a wider understanding of socio-economic deprivation or in some cases even when the internet was available. But we are clear that the development of a new model to challenge men's demand must be informed by such factors that make things better, not worse, for women. And we must shift the burden and focus onto the men who buy sex and have been able to do so for generations without being held to account for their actions. So to support the design, we've tasked a short life working group of experts to consider what the fundamental principles to underpin the model could be, and the group has met on two occasions and is making excellent progress. Its membership includes justice and health representatives, COSLA, Scottish Women's Aid, Violence Against Women Partnership Representation and Public Health Scotland. And the development of principles will create a solid foundation which will uphold the values that we want to see reflected in this model, ensuring women's safety is at its heart. And our ambition is to make very clear what the model stands for and draw on possible areas of consensus, such as the need to further recognise and address the structural and systemic disadvantages experienced by women. So the draft principles are expected by the early part of this year, and we'll further consult to feed further voices into this process. So a national contract has been awarded to an independent research team to undertake lived experience research to better understand current support service provision and the needs of service users, and this will help inform the support aspects of the model. Independent Scottish Government analysis is underway looking at international lessons learned to implementing laws which challenge men's demand, and this will be vital in learning from the global stage on how best to approach this issue. And it's perhaps helpful if I set out that regulation of internet and online service providers is a reserved matter. And we are continuing to liaise closely with the UK government on its forthcoming online safety bill. And on the 4th of February this year, the UK government announced extra priority offences were to be written on the face of the bill, which we understand will include offences involving sexual exploitation. So in principle, this is a welcome move as it aims to make the internet hostile to pimps and to human traffickers. Once we have more detail on that bill, we'll consider that very carefully, especially in terms of the scope of the domestic model that we are developing. So, Presiding Officer, now is the time for progressive and ambitious policies that support women, address the underlying causes of misogyny, and drive forward gender equality. I am heartened by today's debate, and I'm fully committed to continuing to work across the Chamber and with stakeholders as we further progress with the model's development.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I suspend this meeting until 2 p.m. Thank you.